Welcome to Chem Help ASAP. In this video, we will talk about the idea of characterization. Characterization of a product is a vital step in the process of performing an organic reaction. Before we think about how we characterize a substance, let's step back and think about why this is important. A vital idea for experimentation is that if you perform an experiment and disclose how you did the experiment, someone else should be able to repeat the experiment and get the same result. This is reproducibility. The result for a synthetic organic chemist is often the preparation of a molecule. Part of reproducibility for a synthetic experiment is to report evidence that you made the molecule that you claim to have made. The evidence is your experimental and characterization data. By reporting your characterization data, you are allowing someone who repeats the experiment to know if the product that they isolate is the correct one. Therefore, they are able to know if they have reproduced your experiment with the same result or outcome. How do we identify molecules? Well, let's first think about how we identify people. We identify people through many features of a person. Are they tall or short? Wear glasses, have a tattoo, long or short hair. We use traits, characteristics like these to distinguish one person from another. We are very familiar with the features of people. How about molecules? Common organic molecules are not nearly as interesting as people in terms of their appearance. Most pure organic substances are either colorless oils or white solids. Therefore, physical, visual traits are not helpful for identifying molecules. We need something more. Regardless, the physical appearance of a product, white powder, pale yellow oil, is a standard detail to report in an experimental procedure. But appearance alone does little to distinguish, to characterize, one compound from another. On the screen are some of the kinds of characterization data that chemists sometimes report on molecules. These are all methods of analysis and features of organic molecules. This list is not complete, but it covers a number of the types of data that you are likely to encounter in an experimental section of a laboratory procedure. Our goal for this video is not to understand all of these types of data. Instead, I'm going to focus on three items: melting point, TLC, thin layer chromatography, and NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. Let's begin with melting points. The term melting point is a bit of a misnomer. When someone reports a substance's melting point, they normally report the melting range. In general, melting points, melting ranges, are determined with a tiny sample of the substance being placed in a glass tube. The tube is then placed into some kind of melting point apparatus. On the screen is a representative example of a melting point apparatus. The tube with the sample goes into a slot. You program the instrument to warm up slowly. You watch the solid through a viewfinder and record the temperature at which the solid first begins melting to a liquid and the temperature at which the solid has completely melted into a liquid. These two temperatures give you the melting range. How do we interpret a melting point, MP? Let's talk about three ideas. First, melting points often do not match perfectly. Things like heating rate and thermometer calibration differences mean your results on one melting point apparatus may differ from someone else's results on a different apparatus. So if one person gets an MP of 100 to 101 C and another person gets an MP of 96 to 98 C, then those could still be the same substance. Keep an open mind when interpreting melting points obtained by you or taken from the literature. Second, while a substance's melting point is a characteristic of a molecule, a melting point alone has limited value for identification of a substance. Let's say your product has a melting point of 100 to 101 C. If you look up a table of melting points, you'll find that many molecules melt close to 100 C. Just because you have a melting point match does not mean two compounds are the same. Third, a narrow melting range is normally a sign of product purity. Often the value of a melting point is less for identification of a substance and instead evidence of purity. Melting points are normally reported in an experimental procedure using the following format: MP, then the range of the melting point value, followed by parentheses showing the literature value, if any, with a superscript for the reference. And that's a reference citation that will be listed separately in the references section. TLC, or thin layer chromatography, is another characterization method. Just like melting points, TLC is perhaps most valuable as a method for estimating purity rather than identification. Regardless, TLC does have a characterization aspect. A compound that appears as a spot on a TLC plate will have a characteristic RF value. That is the retention factor. The RF value is a dimensionless value between 0 and 1 and determined by dividing the distance the spot has traveled divided by the distance that the solvent has traveled. Just like experimental technique can affect a melting point, RF values should also be interpreted with some flexibility. They vary. If you determine an RF of 0.6, but the literature value is 0.5, then the substance could very well still be the same. Remember that RF values alone are worthless. You must report an RF value along with the mobile phase that was used to elute the TLC plate. The RF value alone, however, is not reliable for identification. Lots of organic substances have the same or very similar RF values. Furthermore, if you consider that RF values are not very precise, then RF values alone are even less useful for identification. RF values are recorded in an experimental section as RF, F is subscripted, the value is rounded to two decimal places, and the mobile phase composition follows in parentheses. While TLC is not great for identification, it is a very convenient method to quickly check the purity of a substance. More spots imply lower purity. If a substance shows just one spot by TLC, then that is evidence for purity. Still, one spot is not proof of purity. Keep in mind that not all molecules show up on a TLC plate. In particular, I normally visualize a TLC with a UV lamp. If the impurity does not absorb UV light, then it won't appear under a UV lamp. Furthermore, it's possible that your product and the impurity have very similar RF values. Maybe they are so close that they appear on top of each other. This is called coelution. If two spots coelute on a TLC plate, then your compound will appear to be one spot, even though it has an impurity. Regardless, everyone likes to see a TLC plate with just one spot. Note that we often use characterization methods together. For example, if your product is one spot by TLC, a sign of purity, and has a narrow melting range, another sign of purity, then you can begin to have higher confidence that the product is indeed reasonably pure. Okay, if melting points and TLCs are not ideal for identification of a substance, then how do we gather evidence that is indeed useful for identification and not just purity? One of the most common methods for product characterization is NMR, nuclear magnetic resonance. NMR works by irradiating a sample with radio waves. Nuclei, especially hydrogen nuclei, interact with the radio waves. The nuclei absorb and later release the energy. The released energy can be detected and interpreted to estimate both the structure and purity of a molecule. NMR is extremely powerful with many applications. Our goal is not to become experts in NMR. We only want to appreciate how NMR can help characterize an organic molecule. In particular, we are going to focus on NMR involving hydrogen nuclei, called H1 NMR or proton NMR. All right, here is a reaction that we might perform. This is a simple bromination of an alkene. Now, when you run a reaction, you will have access to the starting materials. That means you will be able to gather characterization data, including NMR data, on the starting materials. When you look at the characterization data for the product, you can compare the starting material to the product and see what changes. For example, in this reaction, we have a benzene ring in both the starting material and the product. Whatever NMR data look like for benzene, both the starting material and product should look similar. A big change is this alkene and these hydrogens. If NMR gives special data for an alkene, then that data should be very different in the product, which doesn't have an alkene. Let's look at some data. These are simulated NMR spectra from a website called nmrdb.org. To the left is the starter material. You may not know much about NMR, but I'll just say the important details. Around the value of 7, on the x-axis, we have a signal that is 4 hydrogens, that's that red number at the top. These are the hydrogens on the aromatic ring. Alkene hydrogens show up between 5 and 6. We have 2 of them, not drawn very well, but those are the alkene hydrogens. The other 4 hydrogens are down around 3 on the x-axis. Again, we have 4 of them, as indicated by that red number. Now let's look at the product. Just as we expected, the product spectrum is similar. Same number of hydrogens in total, but different because the alkene is gone. The aromatic hydrogens are just about the same. The hydrogens that were on the alkene have moved to between 4 and 5 on the x-axis. The other hydrogens have moved just a bit as well. Hopefully, from these two NMR spectra, you can see that if you have data on the starter material and consider likely changes from the reaction, it's often fairly easy to predict and understand the NMR characterization data of the product. Note that NMR spectral data, which is a combination of where the peaks appear on the x-axis, the chemical shift, the shape of the signals, is the multiplicity, and the intensity of the peaks, call that integration, is highly characteristic for a specific molecule and extremely useful for distinguishing one molecule from another. In other words, NMR data are excellent for characterizing a product. Just as melting point and TLC data are reported in a specific format in an experimental section, NMR data have their own format. That format starts with information on the instrument, the spectrometer. The information includes a number signifying the field strength of the instrument's magnet and the solvent used to dissolve the product. Next is the position of the peak on the x-axis, it's the chemical shift, with the shape of the peak, the multiplicity, and the number of hydrogens that give rise to the peak. That's the integration. For example, the alkene hydrogens in the starting material would be reported with an X position chemical shift of 5.37, a S for the multiplicity of it, that's a singlet, and 2H because the signal arises from 2 hydrogens. Okay, those are the basics of characterization data. We featured MP, melting points, TLC, and NMR data, but there are many other methods. Please subscribe, like, or leave a comment. Take care.